Isaiah 14. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob, and will yet choose Israel, and set them in their own land, and the stranger shall be joined with them, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob, and the people shall take them, and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids, and they shall take them captives, whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors. And it shall come to pass in the day that the Lord shall give thee rest from thy sorrow, and from thy fear, and from the hard bondage wherein thou wast made to serve.
A transfer of rulership is coming, and the kingdom of heaven will be on earth. Righteousness will be spread throughout the whole four corners of the earth. Wickedness will be put down.
If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and faith of the saints.
All right, Shalom. First and foremost, we would like to give all praise and glory unto Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shah, Bahashem, Kapadash. Double honors unto the apostles and the elders of GMS who rule well, teach well, being great examples to his younger brothers. And peace and blessings, salutations to the hopeful that got there pushing his word and truth and in sincerity across the four winds in the name of Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shah. Pushing to get up out of here. Shalom to the hopeful, the believers, the listeners whom have came back to the obedience of the scriptures through faith in Yahweh Bashim Al Shah. All right, we're GMS Mississippi Camp, you know, coming with another weekly lesson, you know, and this weekly lesson is entitled The Patience and Faith of the Saints. Okay, because as we, you know, have been awakened, you know, in the latter time, all right, in the end of the end. You know, we were awakened, you know, right in the climax of the movie, you know, as we fell away from who we were, you know, from 70 AD all the way until now, you know, transatlantic slave trade until now, we fell away from who we were. We became bywords, you know, as was prophesied in the curses. And now as we've awakened to who we are, who our power is, the understanding of the prophecies, the Lord woke us up, right? In the climax of the movie, you know, and what we, my expectation and our hope, okay, is built in something, you know, that was promised, you know, thousands of years ago, you know, and now we're in a time of these things being fulfilled. So I want to get the definition of climax and hand it out to the brother Lamont, all right, and we'll go from there, get some accounts, you know, and build in the spirit, you know, Lord willing. You know, you brothers and sisters are edified. Now, this is the word climax. All right. It says climax has multiple meanings. It says highest point. All right. For one meaning, it says the most intense or highest point in the development or resolution of something. And when you go into the Bible, okay, we are at the highest point. Yahweh Shah returning, okay, is the highest point. His second coming is the highest point of the Bible. And we're right here at the door. Is everything that spoken of, okay, that will be going on right before his second appearance, okay, his second coming, you know, we're living in those times, okay, and we're living in a time where things can take a dramatic turning point. And this is another definition. It says a major turning point or moment of highest dramatic interest. Okay, in a play or other work. And we know that the Bible is pretty much the movie of the Most High, you know, for existence. You know, we have to understand that we exist, okay, within the script of the Most High's movie, okay? And the Bible explains, you know, it pretty much explains the movie, the characters, okay, what's going to happen, the drama, okay, as we come into a time where things are going to take a dramatic turning point, you know, when the C-HIP is mandated, okay, when things hit the fan, civil unrest, you know, famine, okay, things are going to take a very dramatic, you know, turning point, okay, leading up to what that high point of prophecy, which is Yahushua. So one more definition and some synonyms to go with it. All right, so this is just a Google definition of climax. It said the most intense, exciting, or important part of something, a culmination or apex, okay? And you go into some of the definition. It says a peak, a pinnacle, okay? It literally says the best part, okay? The summit, you see? And this is where we're at. You know, we're the best part of the movie, okay? Well, eventually the elect, you know, will be shown favor, you know, be preserved, you know, through this dramatic turning point, okay, and delivered at the return of Yahushua, which is the highest point of prophecy, man. You know, and this is something our forefathers would always inquire about, you know, and the brother has the accounts that goes into it, you know. So I'm going to get that in the book of Acts for the brother, but you got it from there. You want any brother had anything you want to say something before we get into his account? Okay, come. So let's get into the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 1. Lamai, you got it, bro. It says this Acts 1:1. It says the former treaties have I made of Theophilus, which that's another name for Luke, of all that Yahushua began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of the Most High, and after being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me.
Come. So when Yahushua was beamed up into that chariot, man, that from that point, man, this had been a time of pretty much patiently waiting for his return, you know, and the whole thing about waiting is pretty much that, you know, you wait, you know, which that waiting going to take patience, man. If you're waiting on something, you have patience, that believe you truly believe in something to occur or something to happen, you know, and we, through the spirit of Yahweh Hashem Yahushua, having faith and believing. And Yahweh Hashem Yahushua, as scripture says, his words are faithful and true. Okay, we're patiently waiting for the return of Yahushua, you know. And as our forefathers was you know, hoping that Yahushua was going to restore the kingdom of heaven, you know, there has been particular events happening, and we was hoping that, you know, saying the process was going to be real swift with the restoring of the kingdom of heaven, you know. But we know we also have particular or other prophecies that have to be fulfilled, man. So we're anxiously and hasting the return of Yahushua, but yet and still, we're not on our own time. We're on the times of Yahushua. So therefore, we have to, you know, be steadfast and just patiently wait and continue to do the work, you know, until all these prophecies are come to pass, man. Mm-hmm. You got it, bro.
Come on, bro. So let's go back into the book of Acts. It just got the word infallible real quick, and it says capable of making a mistake or being wrong, you know. So mm-hmm. The Bible is undefeated, you know, as we see everything is playing out, you know, exactly according to the script. Okay, shows that hey, the Bible is incapable of being wrong. You know, right. You might have wrong misinterpretation, but the true interpretation of the Bible is incapable of being wrong. You know, it's the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 5. It said, for John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. When they therefore will come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them,
okay,
you got it.
And see that's that point where you know the apostles was you know hasting for Yahushua to restore the kingdom of heaven, man. But like again, there are other prophecies that had to come to pass. Other things had to transpire before this time. But as the priest mentioned earlier, we're in those times now, man. Even though we're still hasting, we see the finish line, if you will, because the things that have been written, we're seeing them manifest before our eyes. You got it, bro.
Come, bro. Verse 7, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power.
And see, that's where a lot of men who was in this truth, you know, fell off because the apostles speak on it and the elder bishops and brothers on down when it came to year 2000. You know, there was an anticipation or expectation of Yahushua's return, man, and bringing forth the kingdom of heaven. But it wasn't our time, man. It wasn't that time, you know? And how could it be if everybody was just expecting and anticipating it? You know, because scripture said that Yahushua will come back like a thief in the night, man. So it's going to be at a time when nobody's truly ready or expecting it. Yet you're expecting it. It's not going to happen when people think it is. The Lord is going to bring it as he said, a thief in the night, you know? So again, as much as we want the kingdom of heaven to be established, as much as we want Yahushua to come back, you know, the Lord is the man that he will not lie. So he's bound by his word. So these things are going to transpire the way the Heavenly Father sees fit. Because as we keep going on, it's going to show that even Yahushua doesn't know when he's going to get that green light.
Come on, bro. I got a quick one for you real quick. Since you said that dealing with the year 2000, you know, which Yahushua, he prophesied about that, you know, his men, you know, wanting to see him, desiring to see him, but wouldn't see him, you know. So this is Luke 12 and 37. It says, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meet and will come forth and serve them, you know. And they're just showing, you know, how Yahushua is going to honor, you know, those men that waited it out, you know, because, you know, if you're invited to the feast of a king, you know, and that king serves you himself, okay, the king himself serves you, you know, that's the highest honor, right, you know, you can have, okay? So they're just saying Yahushua, you know, he's going to give those men high honor that waited. Okay, verse 38, it says, and if he shall come in the second watch or come in the third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. So, you know, as the apostles, you know, our elders, the elder apostles, you know, if they was awaiting and they desired to see Yahushua, you know, Yahushua, like, I might come in the second watch or the third watch, you know, but it just showed that those men were on their watch, you know. Hey, you best believe, you know, we're in that third watch now, you know, to where he can come at any moment. And it's not a date, you know, that you can put on it. You know, you just have to be in the spirit and be circumspect and be in tune with prophecy, man, to just understand how close we are, you know. So, yeah, back in Acts, bro.
Bro.
All right, this is the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but ye shall receive power After that, the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts, all right, of the earth. And when he has, oh, you got it, bro.
Okay, because what we're doing, it shows power, man. I mean, you know, of course, it's not no power to the sense where we're able to manipulate the elements and everything, but it's a power, a spiritual power that the Lord is bringing forth, utilizing his men, starting with our apostles, our elder bishop brothers on down, and even our apostles, their leaders, man. Okay, because men have been awakened and heard this word across the four winds of the earth, where this word has went, man, the diaspora. Men are has hearkened and took heed to this truth, and they're out on the highways and byways teaching and preaching this gospel, okay, teaching and preaching this truth, making their bodies a living sacrifice, man. And that's power, man, by way of the spirit and the power you have by Shimmy Al-Shah. You know, because it's not a small thing to see men in this day and age, man. And it started back in 1960, you know, Abba Bivens, High Priest Ariya, Masha, you know. And now we have our apostles, our elder bishop brothers on down. And this was fruit that began in 1960, man. Now there's like a forest of fruit through the spirit and the power you have by Shimmy Al-Shah, steady bringing forth fruit, man. So this is just a small portion of power without actually being able to have those spiritual powers on earth, man, that the Lord is manifesting through his men.
Come,
you got it, brother.
Come. Right back in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 9, it says, and when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Yahusha, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven.
And that's what we're hastening the return for, because we know Yahawashah was beamed up or taken into a chariot, man, where he was going to sit on the right hand of the Heavenly Father. And we know the scripture said that he, behold, he come up with cloud, man, meaning the same way the angel was saying that Yahawashah, as he departed and went to the Heavenly Father, he, by way of chariot, he's going to return in that same fashion. He's going to come back on their fathership, okay? And he's going to pretty much take the crowns of these so-called kings of the earth, man. And that's when righteousness is finna start being developed on the earth, man. That's when righteousness is finna start being implemented on the earth, okay? Because this wicked rulership is finna be taken down, man. And we see Yahawashah is already visiting the earth, which he created, man, by way of the Heavenly Father, by all the things we're seeing happening, man. The uproars of the people, okay, the earthquakes, the hurricanes, the tornadoes, you know, which are the winds, you know, the hearts of many growing cold, you know, wickedness flourishing, people giving in to their own lust, doing things that's unseemly. All these things are prophesied that was going to happen, man, before the return of Yahawashah. And it has gotten to the point where it's wickedness, as in the days of Noah, is polluting the earth, man. So this man has a ceiling, man, that he's not going to go beyond, because he has been a cancer on the earth, in the earth, man. So we know Yahawashah is going to return, man, because this place is completely filthy. Okay. And the Lord is shortening the times, you know, for the elect's sake, as it is written, because we see how the days are moving by quickly and swiftly, man. You know, you get up on Monday, you go to sleep, before you know it, it's Friday, we at camp. You know, so we know your house is getting ready to return, man. But it's all about your endurance. It's all about patience. It's all about faith. It's all about hope. You know what I'm saying? And those things, those four things, you know, you got to continue to hold fast to. Because if you start getting weary and losing doubt, on losing strength or losing faith or losing hope, you know, hey, you really gonna get yourself in a bad position, man. Because faith, man, is that gift. We'll say faith is the substance of things hoped for. And what we hope for, Yahweh Shah to return. We hope for the promise to be given to us as an inheritance, as it was promised. Okay, and the substance thing hope for, the evidence of things not seen. And when you go into Ezra, it says what? Blessed is them that have not seen in bodily eyes, but yet believe the things that I say. So faith is something, man, that has to be a gift given by Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shah. Because if you're not really rooted in this truth, man, and if you don't believe the things that you read, you don't believe the things that brothers say, things that brothers are teaching, the signs that you're seeing when it's according to the scriptures, then your lack of faith is gonna put you in a position of possibly being over two-thirds, man, within the valley or the body of the dry bones, man. The congregation of the dry bones. So patience, man, and faith is very important in this truth, man. Because this is what the scriptures say, the race is not for the swift, man. So we're not on our time. We're on the time Yahweh Shah. You know, this thing could the Lord Yahweh Shah could come back in 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 years. But nevertheless, we have a job to do as men of the Lord to keep our faith and keep believing and keep pushing and doing what the Lord ordained us to do until his return, man, until that famine of the word comes, okay? You know, because we know it's going to be a famine of the word. Why? Because the scripture says it. You know, scripture said what? It's going to come a time where it's going to be a famine, not of food of the thirst, but of the word, roughly paraphrased. So we know that the devil gonna come down that great wrath. We know that persecution is coming. We know we're not gonna be on the internet and on the street corners forever. But when that happens, do your faith end with that, or do you continue to believe and keep pushing? Because when you're not around brothers, when you're not fellowshipping with brothers, when the shit hit the fan, you know there's gonna be that test of belief, of the faith, of hope and endurance, you know, to continue to believe in what you've been taught, what you've learned, what the elders and apostles, bishops, brothers on down have been teaching all this time. You got it, bro.
Come on, bro. Any of y'all brothers had precepts before we go to the next account?
Yeah, bro, I got a precept.
What you got, bro?
Give me Sirach 2:2-14.
Sirach 2:14, bro. Let's All right, this is the book of Sirach, chapter 2, verse 14. It says, woe unto you that have lost patience, and what will you do when the Lord shall visit you?
Come. Yeah, woe unto you that lost patience. And like a lot of people came, it's true, and they went back into the world, man. All right, they just basically gave up. They gave up on Yahweh Hashem Rashad, man. And some of them done it. They quit. I mean, they quit before it got bad out here, man. And another thing, the Lord ain't giving nobody that you have it in the world. You have it in the truth. You gotta be all the way in this, man. And nobody like a quitter, man. And people quit, man. They have no idea what they lost. Mm-hmm. And we, man, the Lord said he gonna give us a crown, man. and everything that's go with it, man. And you quit on the law, you said the truth because of a situation. Hey, man, people like that, man, you can't trust people like that, though. just quit on you. They quit on everybody, man. And all them sheep. People waiting for you to do a lesson. You ain't doing no lessons. You ain't teaching. You wrong.
I got a quick precept for you, bro.
Go ahead, bro.
This is Hebrews 6:10. It said, "For the Most High is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed towards his name, and that you have ministered to the saints and do minister."
Come, and man, look, the Lord see us, man. The Lord see us doing the work, man. And he not gonna forget that, like you said. He know exactly what we doing. But our job is, we just gotta be patient, man, and wait for the Lord, man. Cause you know, the apostles, this is what happened in 2000. It didn't happen. They could have fell up. They could have went back to the world, but guess what? The apostles kept on going. Because they see mm-hmm. the bigger picture, man. They mm-hmm. see the bigger picture. Right. That's just all I got, bro.
Hey, I got a precept for the elder. I got a precept for the elder, Talk to One.
What you got, bro?
The book of Luke, chapter 9, verse 62.
Said Luke 9:62. Okay, come on. All right, get back over here. All right. Mm-mm. All right, this is the book of Luke. Uh-oh. All right, this is the book of Luke, chapter 9, verse 62. And it says, "And Yahusha said unto him, No man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of the Most High."
Hey, come. That's right. You started this, but you looking back on I could have done this. But you looking back, bro. We ain't looking backwards, man. We looking forward, because what in the fuck is here? What's here? I gotta get them, go to fucking work tomorrow. Long, I gotta go fucking cut some grain for Esau. What the fuck is in? You in the truth. You see what we gonna get. But you steady trying to look bad, trying to get this bullshit. All this shit gonna disappear.
Mm-hmm.
But with the Lord got us, with the Lord gonna give us, Lord, we'll be part of the elect, bro. We gonna have abundance, man. We gonna have so much. And everything gonna be righteousness, man. That's the kicker. Everything gonna be righteous, man. It's not gonna be wicked. Esau ain't trying to do you wrong, this and this and that. You're gonna be good. But you put your to the plot, and then you want to go back in the world, man. Hey, you stupid, to be honest with you. But that's all I got, bro.
Come on, bro. Yummy, you had something, bro?
Come on, bro. What the L was going into, it made me think about, you know, he said nobody likes a quitter. It made me think about sportsmanship. You know, and that word I got over here in the Google definition, it's a fair and generous behavior or treatment of others, especially in a sports contest. And in this sport that we in, basically, we're in a race, you know, basically trying to endure our way to the end and run this race, you know, and basically pace ourselves, but not give up, not turn our back to emptiness, because or this, you know, the world, or turn our back to the truth, or to Yahweh Bashem Yahweh. And because turn our back, you forfeit the prize, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Whether win or lose, you forfeit the prize, which is salvation. You know, your eyes not single anymore. You know, you're not looking for to the prize that Yahweh Bashem Yahweh got for those that endured the hardness as a good soldier. And that led me to the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy 2. You can start at 1, bro, and read down to 4.
2 Timothy
2
and verse 4. All right. Second Timothy 2:1-2.
Yeah, come.
Oh, come on. All right. This is the book of 2 Timothy 2:1. It says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Yahushua HaMashiach, and the thing that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Yahusha HaMashiach. No man that warreth entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him that have chosen him to be a soldier."
Read verse 5, Baba Kashah.
All right, verse 5 says, "If a man also strive for masteries, yet it is he is not crowned himself, he scribed lawfully."
Yep, and then here it is, we gotta go according to the guidelines of the race, you know, basically enduring. You know, one of the guidelines is to have faith, of course, you know, because we gotta believe in what we don't see. And we under this grace period, under the favor of Yahweh Shem Yahushua, and Baba Kashah, will you get the word endure in the Google definition?
Endure on the Google.
Come on, bro.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because again, hey, this is what Yahweh Shem Yahushua expecting for his elect to do, you know, because this is what the elect gonna do.
Okay, this is the word endure, so like. All right. Pull it up. All right, so this is endure. It says to suffer something painful or difficult patiently, to remain in existence, to last.
Yeah, know? Man, this is what we gotta do all the way to the end. Hold, scripture say, hold thy crown, you know, hold fast, you know, keep. We gotta hold our crown, man. That no man, we gotta hold fast that no man take our crown. You know, here it is. We gotta stay in this thing that we've been called into, so that Yahweh Shem Yahushua don't see no need to replace us, you know, so that we can, at the end of the day, we can get everything that we've been basically we've been called to get, man, you know. And the thing we've been called to get first, again, first we got to have the faith, like the brother lesson going into, the faith and the patience, you know, because that goes hand in hand, you know. We got to have the faith. We don't see it, and we got to wait for it, because we don't know when what we're waiting for coming, you know. But according to the scriptures, we got the prophecies to look forward to. And we know, according to these prophecies, that Yahweh Shem Yahushua is moving according to how he say he's moving, you know. And we know, like you say, even you say, hey, the scriptures undefeated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just a matter of time before these things just come to pass, and the things that we're looking forward to. People may have misinterpreted it, but here it is in these last days, you know, we got our elders. Basically, they don't set the guidelines, you know, under Yahweh Shem Yahushua of what we ought to know, you know, or what we ought to look forward to. And that is, you know, basically prophecy happening. People falling out. You know, World War III happening, the microchip being pushed, you know, of course, the microchip before World War III, Jacob's trouble, you know, and all these things, and then the crown, Yahweh Shai coming to crown his elect, but before that, coming to take the crown of these kings, man. So it's a process, you know, and it ain't gonna happen how it's exactly we wanted to have, we know we want it fast, you know. But at the end of the day, that's what endurance is about. We gotta last through this process, man.
Come on, bro. So we you had that account you wanted on, bro?
We can go to Revelation 14:9 if another brother didn't have nothing they want to bring up.
You were good, you were good.
Yeah, that was it on that, bro.
All right, come on, bro. The water. You said Revelation 14, what, bro?
It's about at verse 9, and we're gonna go to 12. I'll make a point on verse 9.
Okay, this is a Revelation 14 and 9. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand.
Right. So, and this is coming to that point, you know what I'm saying, the hour of temptation. And when your patience and your faith is going to be tested. Okay. And what's going to be brought to the forefront is Revelations 13 and 16, that MOTD, you know, this is going to be brought out for everyone that's going to be called to take it. Small, rich, poor, you know, everybody's going to be presented when it's mandated to take this corruption, you know, but that's when you're going to, that's when you're really going to be faced with a reality that truly is going to determine whether you're going to receive salvation or you're going to receive that wrath of Yahweh Shai. You got it, bro.
Come. Verse 10, it says, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of the Most High, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb.
And verse 11, bro.
Okay, it says, and the smoke of their torment ascended up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, nor worship. I said, who worship the beast in his image, and whosoever receive the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. You got it, bro.
I was saying, because that judgment is gonna come, man, by way of thermonuclear missiles. It's gonna come by the way of Yahweh Shai, the holy angels, those chariots, those beams, you know, the laser beams bringing forth judgment, man. Scripture goes into when Yahweh Shai comes back. What if it was already kindled? You know, and the earth is already gonna be, especially in Babylon, is already gonna be in complete chaos. So therefore, it's gonna be fires everywhere, you know, all kind of chaos going on. And Yahweh Shai is just gonna come back and add flames to the fire, if you will. But like you say, the nuclear missiles gonna be shot off. Okay, Yahweh Shai is gonna come back with the heavenly host of angels, those chariots, and ultimately, America, aka Babylon, is gonna be a wasteland, man. It's gonna be completely eradicated, man. It's gonna be inhabited by particular files of the earth and desert creatures, man. But before all that even happened, those who take that karagma, those who bow the knee, those who give that reverence to Esau Edom, which is the average Satan's protege, if you will, you're gonna receive a horrible death. You know, this place is gonna be destroyed within an hour. But hey, Yahweh Shai could allow your body to be tormented, you know, leave your spirit in your body for that whole hour, man. You know, so as the scripture says, it's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living power. You know, you got it, bro.
Come, and then you go into it like the Lord, you know, he can control time, you know, so he can make, you know, 5 minutes feel like days, months, you know, so
right.
Why it's a fearful thing to fall into the hand of a living power, you know, because that's why I say the scriptures say fear, you know, him that can destroy the body and soul. But like you say, the Heavenly Father can just leave your spirit in their body to feel their pain, and he can stretch it out. You know, he can make, you know, 5-10 minutes feel like what he wanted to feel like, you know. But ultimately, this scripture is speaking of the nuclear destruction, the judgment, you know, for taking the sea hill. All right, the karagma, okay, which Jacob tried to use this, you know, because Jacob tried to use this to teach hell. It's not speaking about hell, okay? That's the torment, all right? Because that's the Lord's wrath. Like, here it is. This is the Lord's, you know, ultimate wrath is the nukes and the return of Yahushua. So you know it's not going to be a quick thing. You know, it's going to be a thing that the Lord, hey, you best believe he going to manipulate the time. All right, to make a statement in the earth. As the scriptures say, the Most High is known for his judgments, you know. So, yeah, bro, water for clarifying it, you know, because Jake, you know, they make a whole hell doctrine off on that precept.
Right.
So this is Revelation 14:12. It said, here's the patience.
Hey, bro.
Oh, no, you got it, bro.
When you read 12, Baba Kassah, after you read it, in the KJV, can you read the NLT?
Okay, come. It said, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of the Most High and the faith of Yahweh Shai. So let's get in NLT. This is Revelation 14:12 in the NLT. It said, this means that the Most High holy people must endure persecution patiently, obeying his commands and maintaining the faith in Yahushua.
Come. And hey, the brother Yom Yom Yah just brought up the definition for enduring. Because endure, it goes into suffering, man. And suffering is equivalent to having patience. Because when you have patience, you're waiting. And when that wait, there's suffering, man, because you want something to happen, you know, or you're anticipating something to happen. But in the midst of all that, you're dealing with particular things going on anyway. And we're going to have to endure persecution, being demonized, you know, people trying to literally put us to death, you know, concentration camps, being in just in being pilgrims on the earth. You know, I mean, because there's going to be militia groups. It's going to be just particular armies, groups that done went rogue and got their own. I guess you could even say they'll turn militias. You know, have militia group. But the point is, we're going to have to endure a lot of things, man. You know, because there's going to be that test of faith. That we believe that the Lord is gonna do what he said he's gonna do. He's gonna take care of us, man. We have accounts we can read that goes into our forefathers going to particular things and the Lord being there for them. One I always relate to is Elijah in the wilderness when the Lord sent him to the brooks to drink water during the famine, okay? And then when the brook dried up, he sent him to the widow woman and she made cakes for him and she fed him before she fed herself as well as her ill son, and through the spirit of power, Yahweh Shimei Al-Shai, he healed her son, man. And that was equivalent of a standard being lifted, man, where Elijah had that spiritual power. And that is going to come to brothers, man, in this time, because the Lord said he would give us fame in the land we were put to shame. So the Lord, eventually a standard is going to be lifted, man. And brothers are going to have particular spiritual powers to be able to heal, you know, maybe be even able to, teleport. Who knows, man? Who knows? But we know that the Lord works are faithful and true. Eventually things are going to start happening that we really just can't quite fathom right now. But that's still... we have to have that faith this is going to happen, man. We still have to believe that these things are going to happen. But in the midst of all that, we have to endure anything we have to go through right now, man. Again, the persecution. And we know that's coming, man. What the Lord said that the servant not greater than the master, okay, that we will surely drink from that cup. So we're going to have to go through things that the Messiah went through, man. But we still have to be steadfast and unmovable. Okay, we still have to stand stiffly for the name Jehovah Shimei Al-Shai. And that's going to be tested, man. You know, who knows what kind of situation we're going to be in? Who knows what kind of, you know, depth is going to be happening around us, man? Using your family members to try to get you to denounce the name Jehovah Shimei Al-Shai. You know, a time like never before this, since there was a nation. That's not a light scripture, man. That means things are gonna be fucking outrageously crazy, man. But we still have to believe in Yahweh Bashimi Al-Shah and have faith in Yahweh Bashimi Al-Shah. Okay, and our forefather Isaac, man, you know, he had such faith in Yahweh Bashimi Al-Shah, he was ready to sacrifice his son, man.
Now, Abraham.
You know, because he believed Salaki, yeah, Abraham, he would be sacrificed the water, Salaki, brother. Abraham was going to sacrifice his son Isaac, man, because he believed in Yahweh Bahashemi Yahushai so deeply, man, that he was ready to do that. And that's true faith, man. And that's truly believing. Okay. And the Lord is going to take some of us, man, to that point where you're going to go through maybe with something and until the Lord allow angel to stop you, man. But you have to have still, you have to believe Yahweh Bashimi Yahushai, man, because the times we're coming into, it's going to be times that we have never experienced. So therefore, we have to believe Yahweh Bashimi Yahushai, man, for we can have that guidance, those names to call upon, those names we can pray to, that we can receive clarity, where we can receive guidance, where we can receive understanding on particular situations, man. That's all I got, bro.
Come on, bro. Your brother have something?
Yeah, bro. Real quick. I mean, just straight to the point. Can you get in the GNT for me, Baba Gashai? It's going to be 2nd Ezra 8 and 50.
Yeah, give me a little second. You can make your point. Let me pull up the GNT.
Yeah, because you know, the brother saying, you know, this is all for the elect, but he's saying, and the elect is going to have these things, you know, because the elect going to be the elect, but for these other people, for the majority, and this is going to be a fearful thing, to fall into the hands of Yahweh Shem Yahushua. Because Yahweh Shem Yahushua is going to bring all these miseries and this and all this hell and chaos on the earth, and these people, they just not going to be ready. You know, and no matter how many lessons done went out, and no matter how many times somebody that came across a video or stumbled across a brother on the street, they still won't get it, you know, for them. Mm-hmm. That's not a part of the elect. But the scripture say the elect have obtained it. They have obtained it, right? And you cannot see, the elect won't be, they won't be tricked, beguiled. They won't be basically deceived, man. So, but these other people, there's no hope for them because they don't have it. They don't have the faith of Yahweh Bashimi Al-Shah. They have faith in other things, but it won't be in Yahweh Bashimi Al-Shah. Their faith is in themselves, Esau, and the things that the world have to offer. Mm-hmm. So this is why Yahweh Bashimi Al-Shah, you know, Ezra's, you got it, bro.
Come on, bro. This is 2nd Ezra chapter 8, verse 15 GNT. It said, the people of this world who have lived their lives in pride and arrogance will suffer many things in the last days.
Yep, I mean, that's a simple, straight to the point. They're gonna suffer a lot of shit in these last days, which is gonna be hunger, famine. Basically, they won't have the hedge of protection. They're gonna suffer violence. They're gonna suffer all these things that Yahweh Shem Yahushua got against them, because they continually pushed the Holy One to anger. You know, they push Yahweh Shem Yahushua to anger against him, man. They provoke Yahweh Shem Yahushua, and then here it is, they question Yahweh Shem Yahushua without actually going into the mindset of Yahweh Shem Yahushua, which is through, just basically trying to see what the Lord is saying. You know, basically they lean up on their own understanding. So the Lord's gonna give them over to the hands of this damn devil and the hands of these certain spirits that's created for vengeance. You know, at the end of the day, all because they have not that protection that the Lord is providing. And they just on the other side of the story, man. I mean, they in the book, but it ain't the book of life, you know? No. Yeah, they written their end somewhere, but they are, you know, they left on the other side, man.
Yeah. Like they predestined for you know, their judgment, their wrath, you know. Good. Well, everybody's predestined, you know, either for mercy or for wrath, you know. I'm gonna read verse 51 real quick too. It said, but Ezra, you should be thinking about the glory that is waiting for you and those like you. You know, you got it, bro.
Yeah, yeah, because Ezra's a part of the elect, you know. So what the scripture saying, I think is what is it, 1 Peter 4:17? You know, basically, you just think about those who are gonna obtain salvation. If you want to get it real quick, bro. You know, don't I think it's 17, Bible. 1 Peter 4:17.
Mm-hmm. Okay, come on. All right, we'll go.
No, it's not 4:17. I think it's 2:17.
2:17.
It's 2:7. It's 4:7. I think it's 4:7. 2:7. Hold on a minute. What scripture say? Basically, don't worry about them. You know. Let's see. I forget. I ain't business description in a minute.
He said, "You sure it's in Peter?" And what did it say, bro?
It says, basically, don't worry about how the ungodly should not be saved.
Yeah, that's in Ezra too. Yeah, that ain't about Ezra.
We can get that real quick.
Yeah, that's in Ezra the second chapter as well. Let me see, chapter 9. So don't ask, this in the GNT, so don't ask any more questions about the large number of people who are lost.
Yeah, so we're supposed to be we're supposed to really worry about the elect, sit on the elect so that the story could be written and be fulfilled, you know. So and because that's who you have Hashem Yahshua send his prophets to seal the elect. You know,
yeah, but we're in a time now, you know, we're not reaching back, you know, for niggas, you know, and the nigga woman, you know, the Lord got his elect moving, you know, they believe. Because one thing about with the elect, you know, you don't have to pull teeth, you know, the elect become proactive, you know, when they hear this word, okay? So, niggas, all right, and the nigga woman. All right, they're used to someone trying to beg them, you know, to do right. But hey, we're in the spirit now as we are reaching the climax of these prophecies, man. Like, nah, man, you know, and that's why 2 Ezra 9:13, this is another one. I don't know, as one of y'all brothers can break it down. It says, and therefore, be thou not curious how the ungodly shall be punished and when, but inquire how the righteous shall be saved. Who the world is, for whom the world is created.
Yeah, that's the one, bro. Yeah, so we ain't worried about how. We're not too invested in how these people finna perish. You know, we more invested in the kingdom to come, which is for the elect. You know, which is for those people who basically invested in the society. You know, the future society. You know. They're making investments for the world to come, which is going to be an everlasting kingdom, a continuing city, and it says, and don't be curious on how they're going to be punished, because we are their punishment is evident. But inquire how the righteous shall be saved, and because the righteous, those are the investors for the kingdom to come. You know, start with 144,000. How about Shemuel Shai on top? And because the foundation of it is going to be laid with Yahweh Bahashim Yahweh Shai, the governing body in 144,000, you know, and at the end of the day, it's going to be, again, a continuing city, because it was built on faith, things that you can even see before it even happened, you know. But that faith, I mean, that's what faith is, you know, and striving for the masteries, bro.
Come on, bro. Did you have a closing on Lamont?
Come on, bro. You can just read through in Ezra chapter 2, verse 42 down to 47.
You said second Ezra.
Come on, chapter 2. Verses 42 down to 47. Because at the end of the day, this is the reward of having patience and faith and enduring. This is the outcome, man. This is what it's all about. This is what the fight is for. You know what I'm saying? As a brother brought out earlier, the Lord is not going to forget our labor of love, man. So this is not for nothing, man. You know, though we ready for this to be over with as soon and as quick as possible, you know, having faith and patience, endurance, still, we're going to capitalize off of it, man. But, you know, we just got to keep fighting, man, and keep pushing, regardless, you know what I'm saying, how anxious we are or how much we hasten for Yahweh Shah to return. We just got to remember that he is going to return, you know, so we just got to keep fighting until that day. But there's a reward coming. You got it, bro.
The second Ezra chapter 2, verse 42. I, Ezra, saw upon the Mount Zion a great people whom I could not number, and they all praised the Lord with songs. And then the
elect.
Yep. And then
you got it, bro.
Oh no. Oh, it says in the midst of them there was a young man of high stature, taller than all the rest.
Yahweh Shai.
Come on, bro.
Yahweh Shai.
Yeah, you got it. And it says,
oh, that's it. I'm just calling out.
Okay. It's all good, bro. And it says, and upon every one of their heads, he said crowns, and was more exalted, which I marveled at greatly. So I asked the angel and said, sir, what are these? He answered and said unto me, these be they that have put off the mortal clothing and put on the immortal, and have confessed the name of the Most High. Now are they crowned and receive palms. Then say I unto the angel, what young person is that that crowneth them and giveth them palms in their hands? So he answered and said unto me, it is the Son of the Most High, whom they have confessed in the world. Then began I greatly to commend them that stood so stiffly for the name of the Lord.
And two things about that account that stands out. One is that the Lord has an elect that he has chosen from the foundation of the earth, which he will set them crowns upon their heads, though palms, which represents victory, man. And two, that the name of Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shai is of importance, man, because that's what these men had been documented stood stiffly for, was the name. Okay, so regardless of what particular men or particular groups say, those names are very important and they carry the ultimate weight. All right, and when you be steadfast and unmovable, right, and you believe in the words of Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shai, you believe in this truth, okay, the end result, if you continue to be a faithful servant and the Lord is dealing with you, you're going to receive those palms, man. You're going to receive a crown. You're going to be of the 144,000, okay, that first fruit, okay, a part of that governing body, starting with Yahawashi, King David the 12th, and the remainder of the elect. Okay, those who were chosen, okay, before the foundation of the earth. This is the end game and the beginning of righteousness in the righteous kingdom under the rulership of Yahawashi. But to obtain this, if you don't have faith, if you don't have patience, and you don't have the hope that Yahawashi is gonna return, and his words are faithful and true, and we're gonna be rewarded, okay? And the promise of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is gonna be bestowed upon the Lord's elect. Then you just might as well get ready to come back through the loins of one of the elect men, okay? And that's pretty much it. Hey, that's pretty much all I got, bro.
Come on, bro. So I think the point was made. All right. With the climax of prophecy, you know, and the stage is set, you know, as I'm just getting alerts now, you know, that the small hats plan on attacking Iran when they put all their bunk, they leaders in the bunker. First, them niggas gotta
run. Let's go.
Yeah. Them niggas gonna run in the bunker, then throw a rock. You know what I'm saying? Because they know Iran will pile dry there when they do something. So, yeah, man, Lord willing. Because, like I say, it's they 7 hours ahead, you know. So, it's probably about 2:30 in the morning over there, 2:40, almost 3 o'clock in the morning. That's usually when they get busy, you know, in the middle of the night. So, we'll see. You know what I'm saying? We might wake up. Hey, to some escalations, man. But we'll see, you know. Oh, but God, this all just a token, you know, of the lesson that the brother brought out, that, you know, all our patience and faith, you know, is in this age being destroyed, and Yahawashi establishing righteousness in the earth, you know, and Lord will, we all join heirs, you know. So, you know, with that, you know, we pray, you know, that you brothers, you know, and your sister was edified once again. We're going to give all praise and glory unto Yahweh, Bahashem. No double honors unto the apostles and the elders of GMS, who rule well, teach well, being great examples to his younger brothers. In peace and blessing, salutations to the hopeful. Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom.